Hello, in this tutorial we're going to be doing a lens flare from scratch using Sugar Effects LightPack. Before you do that, we have to understand what elements make up the lens flare inside Sugar Effects. So for that, we're going to be using motion and we're going to apply lens flare to a video clip that we have already in the timeline. So let's go ahead and select the plugin and go into the inspector, filters, and click on the compositing mode. The compositing mode allows you to see the lens flare all by itself on top of a black background. As you can see, the default lens flare basically has many elements. If you notice, there is a glow in the center, as well as several circles going through the line of the reflective artifacts. So if we move this element around, we can see that those elements interact with each other. So in order to find out what elements were used in this setup, we have to enable the statistics panel by clicking on the statistics button. In here, it will tell us that we have indeed one glow, the primary glow number one, and we have four different custom flares. We also have one random flare, a light beam, and a sun. As you can see, the most important elements to create a basic lens flare are the glow, a custom flare, and a random flare. The light beam and the sun usually are added later on to create a little more enhancement on the center. Let's go ahead and in the navigation GUI call up the section for the glow parameters. Now let's open up the primary parameters and click on the solo button. Notice that we can see only the primary glow or glow number one, and you can see the label right here telling us that we're actually editing and looking at glow number one. You can make several changes in here and adjust the glow the way you want it, and you will see the results in the canvas. When you are satisfied with your changes, you can click the solo button again so we can see the whole lens flare all together with the new adjustments. If you want to edit any of the other elements, you just have to go into the navigation GUI and call up the section that you want to edit. In this case, I'm calling up custom flares and I'm going to edit custom flare number 4. Now, in order for me to know which is custom flare number 4, I would have to click on the solo button. Once I do that, I can easily see which one is my custom flare number 4. And then do the adjustments accordingly. So as you can see, the editing process is very straightforward. So in order for us to create a lens flare from scratch, we're going to have to work backwards. That means that to do that, we're going to go ahead and choose a different preset. In this case, we're going to choose the preset number 3, which is the clean start preset. When you select that preset, you can see that you have nothing in the canvas. It is completely black, meaning that there are no lens flare elements enabled. Now let's call up the statistics to make sure that none of the elements are actually available or enabled in the panel. The only thing that we can see is that it is using an obscuration of video. So we're going to go down here into the parameters, open up the obscuration, and make sure that the method of obscuration is none. Now the statistics panel reflects that the obscuration is none. So we can now start adding elements from scratch. The first thing that we need to do is add at least one of the three elements necessary to create a lens flare. For that, we have to go inside the main setup section, scroll down a little bit, and find the elements section. As you can see, the main elements to create a lens flare is a glow, a custom flare, and a random flare. Right now, because we are using the preset called Clean Start, they are all selected in none. So let's go ahead and select at least the glow primary, a custom flare number 1, and a random flare set number 1. Now, if we take a look at the statistics, we have the three basic elements enabled in there. the glow, the primary glow, the custom flare number one, and the random flare set number one. Let's go ahead and jump into the navigation GUI and go into the glow section. Inside the glow section, we open up primary, which is glow number one, and select the solo button. That way we can edit the element we just added. You can choose a preset at this moment, or if you prefer, you can undo that action and start doing your own adjustments. As you know, the glow is created by different objects, so in here you can select many of the objects already built into the plugin, or select user if you want to add your own glow image. I'm going to be selecting glow number one, and I'm going to increase the size a little larger. Also, I'm going to change the color to a bluish color. Now, the intensity is 30, which might be okay looking at the glow on top of a black background, but it might be necessary to adjust it later when I see it on top of my video clip. There are many other parameters that you can actually tweak and adjust, or even include the multicolor advanced settings to create different glows. But at this moment, for this particular tutorial, we're gonna just click on the unsolo button so we can see the blue glow on top of the other elements. Now I'm going to go into the navigation GUI and select the section for the custom flares. Remember that we selected only the custom flare one, and the statistics is telling us that we actually have enabled only the custom flare number one. So I'm going to go ahead and open up the custom one parameters and click on the solo button. I don't see that element in here, but it might be hidden somewhere, so I'm going to move this element around until I see it. And I see it down below here. The element might be a little too far from the center, and I can see that the position in here is minus 2. That might be a little too far for my taste, so I'm just going to bring it closer to the center. I'm going to put minus 0.75. The size is also a little too big, so I'm going to just type 10. And now if I move my center position hat, I can see that indeed the custom flare number one is more visible at all times whenever my center is moved across the canvas. So I think I like that better. Now I can click on the solo button again so I can see the custom one and the rest of the elements together. As you can see, and you can probably imagine already, I'm going to go into the random flare navigation GUI, and I'm going to also open up the random flare number one parameters. Click on the solo button, and now I can choose different presets. So I'm going to go ahead and select party time. I think I like that preset already, but the only thing is I'm going to do probably change the size a little bit. As you can see, this one has many parameters. Most of the parameters in here, they work in conjunction with each other, but in a random way. As you can see, by default, the random flare is using the diminishing values, meaning that when you actually have your lens flare going into the center, the diminishing value of the luminosity of those flares gets minimized or diminished, so it doesn't overblow the luminosity when they are all on top of each other. You can select the transition point and the diminishing amount. To do the adjustments for this parameter, it is a good idea to have your lens flare center in the center of the canvas. So that way, when you move the diminishing amount, you can see how much are you actually controlling when they are all in the center. So I think 76 is fine. Now I can move it, and now it looks more natural. Okay, so I like this setup. Now I go ahead and click on the solo button so I can see my new setup all together in the canvas. I'm just gonna go ahead and remove the statistics panel. Now I'm gonna remove the compositing mode button so I can see how it is working on top of my video clip. I see that the center glow is actually a little too faint. I can do one of two things. The first one is go into the navigation GUI and go into the glow section, and then open up the primary glow and increase the intensity until I'm satisfied. Still, when I move it and put it on top of the bright part in here, it doesn't feel like a light in there. So I'm going to go ahead and add another element. For that, I'm going to go back to the compositing mode, and I'm going to go into my main setup, and then enable another element. The center elements, as you can see here in orange, there are four: stars, light beam, halo, and space objects. If we want to enhance the glow that I was just editing, I should probably either select the light beam, stars, or a sun. So I just enabled the light beam, and I'm going to go ahead and select the light beam in my navigation GUI. Let's open those parameters up and click on the solo button. I can see that my light beam is a little too small and too light. So the first thing I can do, the same as in the other parameters, is select one of the presets that I already have in here. I'm going to go ahead and select the distant sunbeam. I'm going to change the color of this beam to be a little more into the blue shade. Also, I can see that it only has two beams. I can increase that. And also, I'm going to increase the size as well as the length. Maybe I lower the size. I think it's a little too thick. And I'm going to click on the solo button to see how it works on top of my other glow. Let's go ahead and click on the compositing mode and see how it works. Now it feels a little better. If you feel like you need a little more glow in that area, you can add another object. I suggest that you add the sun or a second glow. To add a second glow, you have to go back into the compositing mode, go in the navigation GUI to the main setup, and go into the main setup parameters. In here, just navigate down to the glow selector, and as you can see, the glow selector has glow secondary or primary and secondary both at the same time, and this is the one that we want to use right now. So I'm going to go ahead at the primary and secondary, and I'm going to go into my navigation GUI back to the glow section. And just like before, you would open the secondary glow and click on the solo button and do your editing. So go ahead and make all the changes that you think are necessary. And when you're finished, done, you can actually click the solo button off again and then check your work against your video clip. If that is the preset that you were looking for, now it is a good time to actually go into the preset parameter here and click on the Save As. There, you can say and put your own preset name in there so you can save it and use it later. Later on, if you use any of the applications that are compatible with the Sugar Effects LightPack, like After Effects, Motion, or Final Cut Pro 7, when you go to the presets, you're going to see that at the bottom of the list, you will have your own preset that you created before. In the case that the color of your preset doesn't necessarily match correctly with the video clip that you have underneath, and instead of going and digging inside the parameters of each element and trying to colorize them to be a more compatible color, you can actually go into the navigation GUI, go to the main setup. Inside the main setup and under the settings label, you will notice that you have two parameters that will help you achieve the unity of color that you need. In this case, it is called the main color and the color mixing. If you notice, the color mixing at this moment is zero. Of course, the main color is blue, but we're going to change that. So why don't we take a click on the eyedropper and select a color from the background. Now that we have the color already in the main color, now we can start doing the mixing of those colors. So notice that your lens flare that was a little reddish and bluish at the same time, now it starts to pick up the color that actually is more compatible with the video clip underneath. If you notice here in the lightest part of the lens flare, under the cursor, the pixel values are red in this top area of the interface inside Motion. Notice that when I move the cursor inside that area, the maximum value is 1 for red, green, and blue. Now, that is normal if our plugin is being applied to the video clip, meaning that the values doesn't go beyond 1.0. But if you want to take advantage of the 16-bit capabilities, then the process of applying the lens flare has to be a little different. Let me explain. The first thing I'm going to do is go ahead and click on the video clip layer and duplicate it. When I duplicate it, it also duplicated the lens flare plugin, which I'm going to select the lens flare from the copy and delete that. Now I'm going to make sure that the original video layer is on top of the copy. I go ahead and click on the lens flare plugin, go to the inspector and filters to see the parameters, and make sure I click on the compositing mode. Now we see a familiar look, which is the black background of the compositing mode in the plugin. The compositing mode is precisely used for this process, besides being useful for editing. Now let's go ahead and click on the video clip that has the plugin, and let's go and change the blend mode to add. Now if we go on top of the lightest part of the lens flare, notice that now the red, green, and blue values exceed the limitation of 1.0, meaning that it is indeed being composited in 16-bit colors. Now there is a benefit when you do this process to have the same video clip on top of each other, because not only you get the 16-bit capabilities of the compositing, but also it is useful if you want to try to do professional features such as the obscuration using the same video source. For those of you who don't know what obscuration is, that means that when you move your lens flare away from the dark part, in this case the mountain, it is obvious that the sun or the lens flare that might be part of the sun should be obscured at this moment when it is underneath or behind the mountain. Let's go ahead and browse to the obscuration, or better yet, let's go to the navigation GUI and call up the obscuration section. We can see that the method is none, but we can select the use video source image because this is the one that is going to be working for this particular clip. Not all of the clips that you use in your lens flare making will be usable to use that method of video source image, because you need a contrast image such as this one in order for you to pull out a mask that is going to be usable for the obscuration. In this case, I'm using this video clip because I know it is usable in this example. As you can see, the lens flare already diminished in value when it's inside the mountain, but we can still see some traces of that lens flare. That means our matte is not actually color corrected correctly. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to just move my lens flare over to the right side here. And because I am using this top layer as a blend mode of add, that means it is always adding on top of this one. So I'm going to go ahead and disable the bottom layer so we go back to the dark image background. Now let's go back to the lens flare plugin. And now in the obscuration section, I'm going to enable the preview. The preview does exactly what it means. It will give you a black and white matte representation or preview of how your mask is looking right now. If the gray color actually confuses you, then you can select another color that is friendlier for your understanding. So I'm going to choose red as a mask color. Now down below here we have a parameter in which we can increase the quality of our solver. Keep in mind that 20% will work perfectly fine. Now, if your system seems to have more memory or more capabilities in video, then you can go ahead and increase that solver quality to, let's say, 75%. You will be able to see that the resolution of your preview has increased dramatically. Now, I can see here in the example that the top of the mountain, it is still a little grayish. That means that if I move my lens flare to this area, I will still see the lens flare because it is not completely black, meaning that it's not being obscured by the black color of the mask. So let me move this back out in here, and I'm going to use the control of the colors inside the obscuration section. To control the color of your matte, you have to use the threshold, definition, and matte blur. The matte blur allows to have a really nice transition between the lightest parts of your mask to the darkest, meaning that if you move your flare from the light to the dark, the transition feels very natural instead of a sudden turn off of the light. So let's go ahead and move the parameters of the threshold so we can have a better black and white matte. If you feel like it needs a little more control in the image that you might be using, then go ahead and use the definition as well. Also, the matte blur, the default is a 5 in value, which means it's a very nice subtle movement of from light to dark. But you can increase or decrease completely that transition. As you can see here, now we have our matte completely soft. But I'm going to just bring it down to 10. So it's a more reasonable blur. Notice also that down here it says center elements show behind. And also we have a slider that we can control the image spill. The show behind button actually allows you to see the glow and other center elements behind whenever your lens flare is already inside the dark areas, meaning that it's obstructed. If I go ahead and turn the show behind off, notice that I lose some luminosity in there because I don't see some of the elements behind. I still don't have a really nice black and white matte in here, or maybe I have too much of a blur as a transitional part in here. So I'm going to lower down the blur to, let's say, 3%. So now the blur or the transition is actually minimal, and now for sure, because my lens flare is behind the mountain, we don't see any reflections. So I'm just going to bring it out. And now for the purpose of explanation of this show behind the center elements, I'm going to enable that again. And I'm going to be bringing down the center of this flare inside the black area. I can still see some of the brightness in this area on top on the light part of my mask, meaning that I am seeing the glow behind the mountain. I can increase the image spill if I want to, so that glow is going to show a little more inside or overspilling inside the mountain. If I enable the bottom layer, I can see that effect in here. So let's lower that image spill to 0, and notice that that glow is not spilling anymore on top or inside the mountain. So you can actually change that whenever you feel like it works better for your project. By default, the border frame mask is enabled as well. Let me turn off the bottom layer once again, and let me explain what the border frame might be doing here. If I move the lens flare on this area and I move it up beyond the border of the frame, notice that our lens flares actually disappear. So that means that the border frame is actually working whenever the lens flare actually moves away from the camera view. I'm going to disable it so I can show you the difference. Now if I move my center flare and move it beyond the border, notice that all the flares remain on the screen. So it is a matter of preference. How would you like to have that lens flare acting upon the video clip that you have. But as you can see, it might not be necessary all the time. So it is a good idea to turn it off if you don't need it. Now with this setup, you're already set up for final compositing, meaning that you can put it anywhere. You have the 16-bit color values in here, and then when you move it inside or in the trees in here, you can get the diminishing and turning on and off value of your lens flare. So it will work very natural, and it'll look very realistic. Okay, I hope this tutorial was helpful to you, and if you need any more tutorials, please let us know. Thank you very much.